Hello everyone. In the previous class, we discussed about the Jablonski diagram and we discussed what are the principles behind fluorescence and phosphorescence. In this section, we will discuss about the fluorescence lifetime, how to measure the fluorescence lifetimes, what is fluorescence quenching and what are the different applications of this. When a molecule absorbs light, electrons in its constituent atoms become excited and are promoted to the higher energy levels. So when electrons in this excited states lose energy and return to the ground states, they release this energy in the form of heat or radiations. The light emitted during this process is known as the fluorescence, and the molecule that shows this activity are called fluorophores. The fluorescence lifetime is the measure of the time a fluorophore spend in the excited states before returning to the ground states by emitting a photon. It normally ranges from a few picoseconds to hundreds of nanoseconds. And if a fluorophore is excited, the lifetime is the time it takes for the number of excited molecule to decay to 1 by E or 36.8% of the original populations. As shown here, you can see that the intensity decays. The fluorescence lifetime T is the time at which the intensity has decayed to 1 by E. So this is the maximum intensity. So when it reaches the 1 by E of the original intensity, and the corresponding time is called the fluorescence lifetime, that is represented as tau. We can mathematically represent it as if N star T is the number of excited molecules at any time T, and N star 0, which corresponds to number of molecules, excited molecule at T is equal to 0, then N star T by N star 0 is equal to e raised to minus T by tau. The decay of intensity as a function of time is given by this expression IT, which is equal to alpha e raised to minus T by tau, where IT is the intensity at any time T and alpha is a normalization term, and tau is called the fluorescence lifetime. The knowledge about the excited state lifetime of a fluorophore is crucial for numerous measurements, including quenching, polarization and FRET. We will discuss about quenching and FRET in this class. The fluorescence lifetime is an intrinsic property of a fluorophore. So it does not depend on fluorophore concentrations, absorption by the sample, sample thickness, method of measurements, fluorescence intensity, photo bleaching and or excitation intensity. So it is a crucial factor and it can only vary with external factors such as temperature, polarity and presence of fluorescence quenchers. So it can be used for different sensing application. The fluorescence lifetime can be measured in either the frequency domain or time domain methods. And it is represented in these two figures. This is representation for the time domain method and this is representation for the frequency domain method. So in the case of the time domain method, it involves the illumination of the sample which is contained in a cuvette cells or in tissue with a short pulse of light source. So this is our excitation source, followed by measuring the emission intensity against time. So this is excitation spectra and this is the corresponding emission spectra. Then the fluorescence lifetime can be measured from the slope of the decay, from the slope of the decay of this curve. And there are several fluorescence detection methods are available for lifetime measurements, and of which the time correlated single photon counting, which enables the simple data collections and enhanced quantitative photon counting. The time domain method had challenges like requirement for short pulses, but after the discovery of lasers, we can have lasers with short, very short pulses of the order of picosecond or femtosecond regions. In the case of the frequency domain method, as you see here, the sample is excited by a modulated source of light. The fluorescence emitted by the sample has similar waveform, but it is modulated and phase shift from the excitation curve. So this is our excitation source and this is the fluorescence emissions. That is, in this method, the emission should occur at the same frequency as the incident light, but there is a phase delay and changing amplitude related to the excitation lights. So you can see that there is a phase difference between these two sources and there is a changing amplitude, but the these are of same frequencies. Thus, using this phase shift, let's say delta phi is the phase shift between the light source, the excitation source, and the sample emissions. Then, using this phase shift and the relative modulation, we can determine the phase lifetime and modulated lifetimes. So, for a single exponential lifetime, the values of fluorescence lifetime is related as if delta phi is the changing phase, then tan delta phi should be equal to omega tau, where tau is the fluorescence lifetimes. Next, we will discuss about the fluorescence lifetime based methods. The fluorescence lifetime based imaging methods offer many advantages over the intensity based fluorescence microscopic techniques, because in fluorescence intensity imaging, which provides the information on spatial distribution of fluorophores and can discriminate between fluorophores with distinct spectral properties. However, the intensity alone cannot distinguish fluorophores with similar spectra or distinguish unique molecular environment around the same fluorophores. Whereas in fluorescence imaging microscopic techniques, which can frequently discriminate the spectrally overlapping fluorophores using the fluorescence lifetimes. Another application is the fluorescence lifetime based assays, which has the potential to replace the conventional measurements such as the absorptions, luminescence, or fluorescence intensity based method. It uses the fact that any changes in the physicochemical environment of the fluorophores which can lead to changes in the fluorescence lifetimes. So the lifetime based assays can be developed by utilizing various mechanisms, such as a simple binding assay that involves the binding of two components, of being one the fluorescence label, to bring about a change in the fluorescence lifetime. Another scheme is the fluorescence lifetime based sensing methods, which is based on changes in lifetime or decay time of the probe. The nanoseconds decay time, which can be measured by the phase modulations, so that this technique has been extensively used for sensing pH, the calcium ion, potassium ion, etc. There have been a recent development in the application of lifetime based sensing in tissues and other random media by using the optical probes with excitations and emission spectra in the near infrared region. As discussed earlier, the fluorescence lifetime imaging techniques, which is relatively new techniques and involves the determination of the spatial distribution of the fluorescence decay times at every pixel of an image simultaneously. It is based on the fact that the fluorescence lifetime of a fluorophore will depend on its molecular environment but not on its concentrations. So it can be applied in fluorescence microscopy, where the local probe concentration cannot be controlled. The molecular environment parameters can be measured from the lifetime changes induced by the fluorescence quenching or conformation changes of the fluorophores. These fluorescence lifetime based imaging methods has been used in different biological applications, which includes the scanning of tissue surfaces and skin imaging. Next, we will discuss about fluorescence quenching. So quenching refers to any process which decreases the fluorescence intensity of the given sample. The fluorescence quenching, which is a physicochemical process that lowers the intensity of the emitted light from the fluorescence molecules. A variety of process can result in quenching, such as the excited state reactions, energy transfer, complex formations, and collisional quenching. Various parameters such as changes in pH, concentrations, temperature, viscosity, etc. can also affect this process. So there are basically two different type of quenchings. One is called the static type of quenching and other one is called the dynamic type of quenching. We will discuss about these types in the later slides. It is to be mentioned that there is a difference between quenching and decrease of fluorescence due to some other process like high state of molecular excitement or chemical changes of fluorophores due to oxidation, etc. So we don't confuse those things with quenching. So quenching is a physicochemical process which can lower the intensity of the emitted fluorescence lights. Here you can see an example of that, which is a quenching of quinine, which has got a fluorescence in the blue regions. And on the left hand side, the sample is mixed with chloride ions. so that there is no fluorescence. The light you see here is due to the scattering of the excited light, that is the laser light. But on the right hand side, which is without the chloride ions, which can fluoresce. So due to the chloride ions, there is a quenching of fluorescence on the left side sample. As discussed in the last slide, there are two type of quenching. One is the static quenching and second one is the dynamic type of quenching. So in the case of static quenching, which is caused by the formation of a complex between the fluorescence and quenching molecules. Here you can see this is the fluorescence side molecule and this is the quenching molecules. So when it forms a complex, there is no emission of fluorescence from the molecules. So in the unbound form, the fluorophores are able to emit light. However, after the formation of the complex form, the fluorescence is completely quenched from the samples. That means in this case, the lifetime is zero. There is no emission of fluorescence in the case of static type of quenching. The amount of quenching can be decreases as temperature increases, as equilibrium driven to the unbound state. So increasing temperature can lead to the unbound state, which will reduce the quenching. So this formation of complex form will be taking place before the excitation of electrons. The second type of quenching is called the dynamic quenching, and which is caused by the interaction between two light sensitive molecules, which is a donor and acceptor. So basically it is caused due to the collision of molecules. In this type of quenching, there can be energy lost by internal conversion or by forming an excited state for the quenching molecules. Normally, the donor molecules are fluorophores, which transfers energy to the acceptor, which is a quenching molecule, which may then emit the light itself or completely absorb the energy. So for the dynamic quenching, the unquenched lifetime should be greater than the quenched lifetimes, and the amount of quenching will increase with increasing temperature, because as rate of diffusions can go up with increasing temperature, which is quite opposite in the case of static quenching. In that case, the amount of quenching will decrease with increasing temperature. As you see here, this is the fluorescence emission of the dye, this peak, and this is that of the quenching molecule. You can see that the absorption region of this quenching molecule is overlapped with the dye emission, so that it can reduce the emission intensity because it is within the absorption range of the quenching molecules. Regarding the applications of the quenching process, the quenching is basically a really good visible physical phenomenon. That's why it can be used as an indicator for different molecular processes. So one of the application is the Foster energy transfer, where the donor fluorophores, which can transmit energy to the acceptor fluorophore without coming in direct contact. The fluorescence resonance energy transfer, is also called FRET, is a technique which is used for measuring distance between two light sensitive molecules, which is based on this fluorescence quenching. Another application of this fluorescence quenching is which can be used as an indicator for the DNA hybridizations, where a fluorophore and a quencher molecules are attached to the ends of a single strand DNA and close to one another, creating a loop. As the DNA hybridizes and paired to another single strand DNA chains, the fluorophore quencher complex is pulled apart, thereby allowing fluorescence to produce light. So now the quenching is removed from the fluorophore, the quencher molecule is removed from the fluorophore, so that there will be fluorescence light. The fluorescence quenching process, which can act as an indicator for the potassium ions. In this case, the end of the short DNA fragments connected with a fluorescence dye and a quencher through a covalent bonds are divided in a solutions. Now the dye can produce light because it is apart from the quencher, and if there are any potassium ions present in the solutions, the DNA fragments will wrap around the potassium ions and the endings are in touch with each other. Now the fluorescence and quencher will form a complex, so that the fluorescence emission is quenched and there is no emission of fluorescence. We will end up this section here. Thank you.